Oh, hey, in the previous computer science wrap, I covered what just might be your first data structure. So let's activate that index operator and access more information about arrays. One-dimensional.
An array is a block of memory. Storing many elements sequentially. With an index operator for accessibility, you'll be making arrays for eternity.
Let's say that your sneaker collection is starting to get pretty sizable. This can make it difficult to keep your kicks organized. But if you use a structure, like a shoe cubby, it helps you store, organize, and access your collection. Data structures do the same thing, but for data. It allows programmers to store, organize, and access information. When you declare multiple variables, they're essentially assigned random areas in computer memory. It's sort of like having your shoes all over the place with no obvious organization pattern. But when you declare an array, you get one contiguous chunk of memory, and that chunk of memory is divided according to the array size. It's just like the shoe cubby that I mentioned earlier. We could call it a data cubby. I think it sounds cooler.
Declare an array with a data type. Give it a name and then a size. The size divides the length of the array. Each section has an address for its index or place.
Declaring an array is similar to declaring a variable. You specify the type, then give it a name, but for an array, you also include the desired size. For example, let's make an array of type string named shoes with a size of 3. Now we have contiguous memory with enough space for 3 strings. And at the moment, this array is uninitialized, meaning that we haven't put any data into it just yet. Just like a shoe cubby when you first put it together.
First element, that's index 0. Second element, that's index 1. Third element, that's index 2. The pattern continues until size minus 1.
Our shoe array is pretty small, but the index rules apply for all arrays. The first index is 0, and the last index is size minus 1. So the last index in a 500 element array would be size minus 1. 500 minus 1, making the last index 499. For a 20 element array, the last index would be 19. For an infinity sized array, not a real thing, but if it were real, the last index would be infinity minus 1. Now let's get some shoes into the cubby. Using the index operator, we can put data into the array's compartments. In the first index, index 0, let's put AJ1. In the second index, 1, let's put skate high. And in the last index, size minus 1, which is index 2, let's put superstar. This is just one way to build an array, one item or index at a time. We can also stuff all the items into a single line like so. For a larger array, you'd use a loop to add huge amounts of data, and we'll get into loops in a couple more episodes.
After the array gets the data, access any index. Teleportation chamber, meaning you can skip to any location, giving fastest access to information.
All right, here's another exclusive information section. Arrays are pretty fast. It actually takes time for computers to carry out instructions. It usually seems instant, but if you get enough data, it can take a while. Anyway, here's a book. If I need to go to page 50, I just go to page 50. This is actually page 31, but with that information, I just skip, keyword, skip to page 50. If I needed to go to page 50, but I could only get there by starting at page 0, then page 2, page 3. I don't know how I skipped the first page, but whatever. You kind of get the point. Having to travel from 0 all the way to 50 or 0 to 1,000 is much longer than just teleporting to 50. And that's how arrays do. That's how they're so fast compared to other data structures. This is just a little bit of an intro into data structures and performance. You'll learn more about that if you decide to study computer science. I just thought I would mention it because I also mentioned it in the song and it was like one of my favorite rhymes. When it comes to performance, arrays take the cake. First data structure, make an array. All right, next section. What happens if you go out of bounds?
In terms of performance, arrays take the cake. First data structure, make an array.
I didn't cover this in the song, but let's talk about what might happen if you go outside of an array. Our shoe array has three compartments. What happens if we try to access an index that's out of bounds, like shoes at index 3 or shoes at index 400? With the real shoe cubby, the answer is kind of obvious. You can't access shoes or a compartment that doesn't exist. Also, you can't put shoes in the non-existent compartment. When you declare an array, you get some memory, and that memory is yours to use. However, there are regions of memory used by other processes, such as your operating system and all the tabs that you have open in your web browser, which means that just outside of your array, there may be data being used by other programs, and accessing or modifying that data can cause huge problems. Luckily, most compilers and programs have features to prevent this from happening. Going out of bounds will sometimes cause a program to crash, and this error is known as a segmentation fault, or seg fault for short. As a matter of fact, a long time ago, in my Computer Science is a Lot song, I talked about seg faults. You should check out that song. It's pretty awesome, but also, you're gonna see it anyway because I'm gonna show that clip next.
How much homework you got?
A lot.
How much code you got?
A lot.
Break it into units?
A block.
How many times did you seg fault access memory you ain't using?
A lot.
How much data you got? A lot. Oh, right, hey. This is the end, so thanks for watching, and I hope that my video helps you organize your thoughts and understandings about arrays. If so, consider subscribing to my channel. Leave a like, leave a comment, and don't forget your ABCs. Always be coding.